Good morning, everybody, and can I begin by welcoming everybody back after the summer recess, remind you of the Parliament's rules on social distancing and the requirement to wear a mask if you are moving around or entering or leaving the room. Can I also begin this new session by just reminding ourselves that our task, our job, is to be the people's and Parliament's guardians when things go wrong, to get to the bottom of it, when public money is wasted, to hold people to account, and when lessons need to be learned, to follow up to make sure that they are. I see this committee as being a critical part of a healthy and functioning democracy, and I think it's even more important in the months ahead, at a time when there is renewed pressure on our public services, burned out NHS staff, backlogged justice system, young people who have missed out on education, that we stand up and ensure that we are led by evidence and facts without fear or favour. The first item on the agenda this morning is a decision to take item three in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you. Can I now turn to the main business of this morning's meeting? And it's a chance for us to consider Audit Scotland's strategic priorities and future work programme. And can I welcome our witnesses this morning? We have with us Stephen Boyle, the Auditor General for Scotland. And on a video link, we've got Mark Roberts, who's an audit director for Audit Scotland. So can I welcome both Mark and Stephen to this morning's committee. And before I move to questions from the committee, can I thank Stephen for providing a written report, but also now ask him to give us a short presentation, which will outline the strategic priorities of Audit Scotland and the future work programme. So, Auditor General, over to you.
Many thanks, Convener. Good morning to all members. Excuse me. First, delighted to be with you for the first meeting of the new session of the Public Audit Committee, and look forward to working with the committee in the months and years to come. I'm delighted to be with you to have an early discussion with the committee about my priorities and the focus of my work programme between now and into 2022. The last 18 months of the pandemic have been extraordinarily challenging for Scotland's people and our public services. As ever, I want to pay tribute to the thousands of people who provide our public services, people who have kept our services functioning in sometimes immensely difficult circumstances and at times at their own personal risk. As the committee would expect, public bodies' response to the pandemic shapes my work programme. But equally, many of the challenges facing Scotland's public services prior to COVID remain as important and will continue to be subject to audit work. My priorities and plans for the future therefore reflect our planned assessment of the effects of the pandemic on the public sector and continuing to focus on the issues that were important before the pandemic struck and that remain to be addressed. My paper details the key risks and issues affecting public services in Scotland, my strategic priorities, and the reporting I plan to make over the next few months. At a strategic level, there are a wide range of risks and issues facing the public sector. The table at the end of my paper sets out an assessment of those risks and issues, but I'll briefly highlight what I consider to be seven key themes that I've used to shape these priorities and plans in the Forward Work Programme. The first of these is economic recovery and renewal. Rebuilding and renewing the economy post-pandemic will be critical. This is especially the case as the Scottish budget and the resultant tax revenues are much more closely linked to our economic performance than they've ever have been. Further, we don't yet know what the long-term effects of the UK's exit from the European Union will be on our economy or our population. The second theme in our work programme is that of inequalities. Scotland remains an unequal country. Inequalities in wealth, education, health and opportunity persist despite years of vocal commitment and significant public spending aimed at reducing them. COVID-19 has in many cases exacerbated these inequalities. Tackling inequality in all its forms will require our focus and efforts for years to come. Public audit in Scotland has an important role to play in assessing how well public money is being spent to provide better outcomes. This is a major priority for me, and through our audit work, Audit Scotland will have an enhanced focus on inequality matters. An important element of that will also be about capturing people's experiences of public services through our audit work and through their understanding. Thirdly, convener, is the topic of climate change. The recent IPCC report set out the scale of challenge we are all facing. Meeting Scotland's statutory emissions targets by 2045 and the 2030 interim targets and adapting public services to challenging climate will require massive infrastructural and behavioural change. Public audit will be reporting regularly on the impact public spending is tackling this significant challenge. The fourth theme is that of financial sustainability. The Scottish budget and public spending increased significantly since the start of the pandemic. We have been reporting regularly on the changes to the budget and the risks to public spending over the past year. And we will be publishing our next COVID-19 spending tracker later this month. There remains uncertainty about the size of public spending in years to come and how the pandemic will impact on the long-term sustainability of parts of the public sector. We've previously commented on the financial sustainability of a number of public bodies in the NHS, the Scottish Police Authority, and the challenges that are currently facing local government bodies. Fifth is that of performance delivery. We are already seeing and reporting on the pressure on the performance of parts of the public service before the pandemic struck. In some cases, performance delivery has been severely hampered by the pandemic, with the possibility that progress in these may deteriorate further before they improve. Backlogs in our justice system and our NHS are most visible, and we'll be commenting on the progress that public bodies are making in addressing these system-wide significant challenges. The sixth is that of constitutional change. There are still parts of the Scotland Act 2016 that remain to be implemented, such as the use of VAT powers and aspects of social security powers. Post-EU exit changes through the UK Internal Market Act and the proposed operation of the Shared Prosperity Funds may shift the nature of the devolution settlement further. We are monitoring what this means for our work and the assurances that we can provide to the committee and the Parliament. Finally, digital transformation. There's been a significant acceleration in the use of digital technology over the past 18 months across all our lives. Digital technology can provide rapid access to public services, potentially in a more convenient way for service users and help us lower our carbon footprints. But there's also a real risk that some people and communities experience reduced access and face exclusion from access to public services. We're also considering the audit response to the ever-present and indeed growing threat that cybersecurity hacks and challenges are facing our public bodies. All of these areas will be reflected in our future work programme. But I would stress, convener, that audit remains audit. We'll always be focused on the core elements that constitute public audit in Scotland. Is there good financial management? Are public bodies financially sustainable? Has value for money been demonstrated? How effectiveness have governance and leadership arrangements been? Where necessary, therefore, I will continue to lay in the Parliament Section 22 reports on matters of public interest arising from the annual audit of individual public bodies. There will likely be a number of these between October and the end of this year, following the conclusion of the audits of the 2020-2021 financial statements. I will also lay Section 23 reports on performance audits. As detailed in the paper, work is ongoing on performance audits on investing in skills, replacement ferries for the Clyde and the Hebrides, and annual overview of the NHS in Scotland. These will all be published in early 2022. We also plan to look at what happened during the pandemic and after the pandemic across a range of outputs. We'll be looking at where and how the pandemic pound was spent in Scotland, over 9 billion of it during last year, and around 4 million and growing during the course of this year, 4 billion I should say. And in the longer term, how effective that spending was. Following the process of economic recovery and renewal, and the Scottish Government's involvement and support of that will be critical. We anticipate this body of work will continue for a number of years to come. In addition to our core audit outputs, we are increasingly producing other types of outputs, including briefings, blogs, and web-based updates and analysis. These allow us to comment on key and emerging issues quickly. They are often desk-based and draw on previous work we have carried out or pull together material already published from a range of sources. The Parliament's standing orders allow me to refer such publications to the committee. Then, of course, the committee may decide how to take evidence on them. This approach is part of our efforts to ensure that we are flexible, agile, and dynamic in how we plan and deliver our work and responsibilities. I'm joined today by my colleague Mark Roberts, our Audit Director, who leads on our programme development activity. And between us, we'll be delighted to answer the committee's questions this morning. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. And that was a very helpful introduction to this morning's session. I just wanted to begin by reflecting on some of the lessons from the last session, because this is a new committee, but we need to understand where there are underlying issues that we need to keep fully abreast of. And it struck me in looking at the legacy report from the last committee that they had identified recurring themes that seemed to be common in instances where organisations hadn't met the performance standards that were expected, or indeed where something more fundamental had gone wrong. And they spoke of leadership challenges, poor workforce planning, weak governance arrangements, failures sometimes catastrophic with the ICT projects, and also they reflected on the absence of key data and therefore a failure to properly measure outcomes. So I wonder whether you could explain to us how you plan to keep abreast of those themes and how you expect to be able to continue to explore them in the future work programme.
Thank you. I'll be delighted to say a few words about that, and I'm sure Mark will want to come in as well if there's anything that I haven't covered or anything that he wishes to add. We agree, Convener, it's the PAPL's legacy report from the previous session is a hugely comprehensive assessment, an extremely useful reference point for, I suspect, not just for this committee, but also for how we are shaping our work to support the committee's scrutiny. And many of the recommendations and the findings of that report are reflected in our work programme. We see a real synergy between the legacy report and the themes and priorities of our own work programme in the years to come. Some of these issues have been around for a long time and are not easily solved, and yet nonetheless the importance of public bodies tackling them feels ever more vital. I'll maybe touch on a few of those. So we'll be reporting to the committee through our Section 22 reports in the months to come that will touch on some of the recurring themes, unfortunately, that the committee have explored in recent times. We're cognizant of the fact that it nonetheless remains important to continue to shine a light and strive for both assurance but also improvement. We recognise the twin focus of our work in that regard. So we'll be continuing to report on the areas that you talk about in terms of leadership and the effectiveness of governance, the Scottish Government's overarching role in terms of sponsorship arrangements to support improvement and effective management and service delivery across all the bodies within its remit. And also talking about, as we alluded to in introductory remarks, about how digital will transform public bodies and the important role that we have as public auditor and both commenting on how well that's going and drawing on that overarching reach that we have both across central government to support that level of improvement. And the last point I'd maybe make before I pause and see if Mark wishes to add anything is that we want our work to be both supporting improvement and insurance. And the point that we're thinking really carefully about in the legacy report is that of the recommendations that are made following an audit report, either by ourselves or any conclusions that the committee reaches and publishes. But that's seen to be followed through. The committee will be familiar, and indeed we are ourselves, that you will often ask public bodies and accountable officer when they appear before the committee whether the public body accepts the recommendations and findings in the audit report. But we want to close that loop that goes beyond just that verbal acceptance to actually then seeing those recommendations being delivered. The timeliness of a recommendation, obviously, convener, can change over time. And we recognise that an audit report can be a snapshot, as it were. So some of those recommendations may evolve in their relevance, and we'll always be flexible in that approach. But through our work, we want to provide assurance to the committee that those recommendations, that impact of public audit is happening. I hope that touches on a number of the points you raised, convener, actually, but I'll maybe stop and see if Mark wishes to add anything.
Mark Roberts, do you want to make any further points?
Thank you, convener. Just very briefly, you mentioned in posing the question of workforce planning, and I think that's absolutely right. That's a theme that we will continue to pursue as we go through. I would just add to that, we previously stressed across a number of public bodies and in a number of reports the importance of long-term financial planning, and just making reference to the Auditor General's initial comments about the importance of financial sustainability. I think that's going to be another theme that we'll continue to want to pursue over the next few months and years.
Thank you very much indeed. And I think, you know, we've identified that the follow-up and making sure that there is, not just a one-day inquiry into the performance of an organisation and then we all move on. I think the follow-up is something that we are keen to work with you to make sure we are regularly updated on progress that's been made. Can I turn now to a further number of questions, and I'd like at this point to bring in Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Convener, and welcome, Mr. Bourne, and thank you for setting out your programme and priorities so clearly for us this morning. You talked, obviously, about COVID and the work that you're doing in following the pandemic pound, and I think the committee very much welcomes that, and as you identified, it's £13 billion and counting. So can you tell us more about how you plan to track that spending that has taken place to mitigate COVID, and how you will seek to assess how effective that spending has been?
Thank you, Mr. Hoy. We've published two what we refer to as COVID tracker reports to date that have set out really the quantum of money that has come to Scotland, both by spending decisions of the Parliament, the Scottish Government, and also as a consequence of a flow of funds through Barnett consequentials from the UK Government to the Scottish Budget. Since really the start of the pandemic, I alluded to that we're publishing the third iteration of that later this month. And that's really been characterised as being briefing papers and largely factual analysis. Not in any way a straightforward or simple undertaking, given the scale of funding that's come, the sheer volume of spending announcements that have taken place. I need to check my memory, but certainly over 100 individual changes in spending announcements during the course of the last financial year. So what we sought to do through that exercise was to inform understanding through the previous committee about how much money had come to Scotland and an indication of how it had been spent. Over time, of course, we need to move from what's been spent and then to start thinking about how well that money's been spent. And we'll do that through two main ways. We will be publishing a Section 23 report, a performance audit, in the spring of next year that will look across both central government And working with my colleagues in the Accounts Commission to draw in how well that money's been spent in local government bodies too. So really uncovering the panoply of public services in Scotland. And a crucial reference tool will be through the annual audit work of individual public bodies. So last, when the pandemic first struck in March of 2020, we were really only 2 or 3 weeks away from the end of the financial year. So very few of the monies and the transactions were captured in the annual audit work that was then undertaken. A year on, we now have that data, and we'll be able to record, you know, all those public bodies who have received COVID-related monies and begin to report through our audit work how well that's been spent. And I think the last thing to say is that we don't think that's going to end on the back of the 2020-2021 audit work. We expect there'll be a long tail to COVID-related spending and our associated audit commentary on it in the years to come.
Yeah. And just in follow-up, obviously anybody that puts their television set on will see the impact that COVID's had on our courts, schools and hospitals. Can you explain the extent to which you anticipate that certain sectors, such as the NHS, education and the justice system, have been impacted by the COVID-19 pandemic? And what work will you be undertaking to specifically track their recovery in future months and years?
Thank you. Again, I'll maybe start and invite Mark to supplement anything he wishes to add. Those three sectors are the most visible. I think probably what we've seen across education, justice and our NHS most directly affected the spotlight of how people access public services and how it's been impacted. In terms of the NHS, we'll be publishing our annual NHS overview report in early 2022. And in that report, essentially it's a COVID-focused report commenting on how well public money is being spent in our health services, the service delivery performance of the NHS, and also drawing in the NHS recovery plan that the Scottish Government published last year, and referencing also with that how that interconnects with some of the existing challenges that the NHS was facing prior to the pandemic. Audit Scotland had previously commented on, as it's done in its annual NHS overview reports, but in a range of other NHS related outputs, about some of the challenges that existed around IT and workforce planning in the NHS. So we'll do that there. Of the other two sectors, the committee next week will be presenting our report and briefing the committee on education outcomes, which was a piece of work that I'll of course say much more next week when brief the committee on it, but that also touches on the impact of COVID-19 on our education sector. And again, maybe referencing briefly the previous discussion with the convener, is that given the fluid environment, none of these reports in themselves mark the end point of the conversation. We have a range of options available to us in terms of impact and follow-up, and I think we'll continue to track and monitor. And I think that's one of the real value of what we consider to be a flexible work programme that allows us to take stock on a regular basis and capture thereafter any changes, additions that we'll want to make. I haven't mentioned justice, Mr. Hoy, but I'll maybe invite Mark to do that, given his familiarity with the sector.
Thank you very much. So, just on the justice sector, we published a briefing on sustainable alternatives to custody kind of a few months ago. And in the longer term, we have plans to look at that part of the justice system as a performance audit. But clearly, kind of as we sort of see, and as Stephen says, that monitor what's going on in terms of the backlog, in terms of, in particular, court cases going through, that would be something that we may wish to respond to through future audit work. So, but again, as we now are able to kind of flex and alter our work programme much more quickly, we can kind of assess what is going on as the long tail of the pandemic plays out.
So, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much. Colin Beattie, you've got a series of questions, I think.
Thank you, Convener. Our journalists, sort of three areas that I'd like to focus on. First is in connection with the exit from the European Union. In your opening statement, you made some comment on that. But on the business planning day, you said you were still awaiting clarity on where audit responsibility would lie in relation to the changes that are going to occur. And that is still an ongoing process because there's still parts of that agreement to come into play. The UK internal market and some of the existing devolution areas are currently a little bit in limbo. And I'm wondering what sort of discussions you've been having, presumably with the NAO or whoever, in connection with how these responsibilities are going to be divided up, whether there's still going to be a role for you in there for things like the UK Shared Prosperity Fund, because it's unclear, certainly to me at this point, how that's going to be administered, where it's going to be administered. And of course, all of that leads on to who does the auditing. And I just wondered where you were on that, how far you are in these discussions. Is there any clarity at all, or are you in limbo like everybody else?
I'll do my best, Mr. Beattie, to shine any further light on the matter. You're right, we've identified the UK exit from the European Union as a theme for our work. And on the topics that you mentioned, that's really where we're focusing our current attention. Before the European UK's exit from the European Union, Audit Scotland audited the Common Agricultural Fund as part of a consortium of auditors, a consortium led by the UK National Audit Office. Structural fund arrangements were subject to audit by the Scottish Government's internal auditors reporting to the European Commission. Following the UK's exit from the European Union and the planned arrangements for the UK Shared Prosperity Fund, I think, as I mentioned to the committee in private session, the business planning last week, we're tracking and monitoring it and having discussions with the National Audit Office. After the meeting with the committee last week, I've since had a subsequent discussion with the National Audit Office's Controller and Auditor General about the kind of shared objective that his office, Audit Scotland, and I would presume extending to the other UK audit agencies, work closely together, not just to await, but also to shape the contribution that we can collectively make to auditing the arrangements that are decided by the UK Parliaments in this respect. So I think that probably says that we think that we have an offer to make based on our experience and our involvement in this work, and that's known and understood by ultimately who will be the decision makers. All of that, unfortunately, isn't a definitive position yet, Mr. Beattie, that says I'm clear on how this will ultimately be audited across the UK. What we are clear on is that we've got an offer to make. We're ready and willing to do so once we're able to report back to the committee how we expect that to be taken forward.
So at this point, you're really unaware what your role in the future is going to be once all this settles down?
Like so many other people, we're awaiting clarity. We're continuing to have a legacy arrangement in respect to the Common Agricultural Funds in the UK, in respect of some of the capital schemes that are still operating through the Scottish Government in conjunction with the European Commission. But in terms of the future arrangement and how the auditing of the UK Shared Prosperity will fund, aspects of what that will mean for the Levelling Up Fund and how and if that will apply directly from the UK Government to local authorities in Scotland, we are participating in the discussions and making known our offer and our interest. But like many others, we don't yet have exact clarity as to how that will operate.
I was actually going to raise cap funding. That continues into next year, doesn't it, 2022. Presumably you'll continue your present auditing up to that point, by which stage I'm assuming there'll be some clarity as to how that funding's going to work.
Yes, we are continuing to audit cap funding and expect to do so for probably another couple of years in respect of cap funding, like many other funding arrangements, contain both a revenue annual funding to farmers and crofters, but there's also a capital funding element of it to support farm buildings, other infrastructure works for relevant farms and farming businesses. And that's going to continue for another couple of years yet, and we'll continue to discharge our responsibilities on that point too. What the future holds, it probably is a similar point to the the successor arrangements across all European funding, and you know we're ready and willing and participating in those conversations, but unfortunately not yet able to provide clarity as to how exactly that will operate.
I mean, obviously this committee is very interested in how the audit structure is going to work going forward, but there seems to be an awful lot of gaps, and at the moment you seem to be in the same situation as we are, uncertain.
As we say, we are awaiting clarity. We've made known our interest, and I think based on our experience in this area, we think we've got an offer to make and to support public scrutiny and assurance, but you're right, we don't yet have the clarity we're looking for.
Now, assuming that some clarity does come somewhere down the line, are you ready to carry out any additional work that might be necessary to put that in place, assuming that there is a role for you in this, that there is going to be some function of this within Scotland?
I think the conversation that we'd probably want to take at that point is to gauge the size and scale and scope of those responsibilities, whether that's something that we can accommodate within our existing staffing and resourcing arrangements. And if it's felt appropriate, and through discussions with the Parliament, the Scottish Commission Public Audit and our board, you know, we would look to have those further conversations if it meant a significant shift in scale of the audit activity that was required. As I say, Mr. Beattie, we're ready and willing and I look forward to those discussions.
Just to move on to something slightly different, National Performance Framework. I'm guessing that COVID-19's kind of kicked that into the long grass in terms of measuring the outcomes and so on. But in your report, or in your briefing paper, you talk about the financial pressures that are having an impact on performance of some public services and the impact on delivering these national outcomes. Given the comprehensive impact of COVID-19, it's probably not surprising, but maybe you could give a little bit more background on that.
Yeah, happy to, and again I'll invite Mark to follow with any contribution he wishes to make. Audit Scotland has said many times, both my successor and myself, that we are supportive of the National Performance Framework. We think it makes a welcome contribution to terms of transparency and parliamentarian and public awareness of how well public money has been spent. It's a core part of our purpose that we're not just auditing, you know, what public money has been spent, but actually what outcomes, what difference it's made to users of public services. We'd agree, Mr. Beattie, that, and I think it has been acknowledged publicly on a number of occasions, that the intended outcomes set out in the national outcomes and the national performance framework will suffer as a result of the pandemic. We've seen some of the challenges already across our public services in delivering those outcomes. And what matters, therefore, you know, both in terms of the financial sustainability element of it, but as the government and public bodies implement their recovery and renewal arrangements, that's reflected in realistic but also stretching national outcomes that's reviewed appropriately and set out, say, what can Scotland achieve, and factoring in, none of this is easy, but what the multiple moving parts that exist, that how public services will need to change and evolve, tackle the challenges of inequalities, climate change, digitalisation, access to services. So we'll continue to track the National Performance Framework, national outcomes closely through our work. But what we can expect to see are probably quite different national outcomes. But again, for us commenting that are these realistic, are they reasonable, are they stretching, and how well public bodies are achieving them. Mark Roberts may wish to say a word or two more on that.
Thank you. Just to echo what Stephen said in his introductory comments, I think there's a blend of things that we'll want to pursue. Firstly, the progress against those outcomes, and we were seeing things coming under pressure prior to the pandemic, and obviously there's been the massive and acute shock of the pandemic, which has occupied a huge amount of government and public sector time, and rightly so. What we want to do in terms of our audit response is continue to keep an eye on those long-term outcomes and how well those have been delivered. Our work will continue to be a blend of looking at those long-term, in some cases intergenerational type issues and outcomes, which the National Performance Framework seeks to secure, and also then looking at kind of what has been the short-term impact. I think it's just characterising our future work as a kind of a mix of the long-term and the short-term.
No doubt your reports in the coming months will reflect some of these strains. Just finally, I was going to raise a question of the NFI, which is due next year. As you know, this committee in the past has offered Audit Scotland support in terms of strengthening your hand with that, because there was perceived to be a weakness that this fairly useful tool, in fact, is not mandatory. And it seems extraordinary that councils and so on can decline to take part. It also, if you remember, we talked about other public bodies who might benefit from being part of that, who were not at this point included. And, you know, you don't have the power to compel. And I think the committee had a feeling that maybe you should have. I wondered if you'd had further thoughts about that. How are you going to make NFI really effective next year? And how are you going to deal with bodies that can't be bothered to take part? And given the fact there's been all the COVID, there's been COVID and everything, these bodies have been under stress, under strain. This may not be a priority for them. How are you going to handle that?
Thank you. Maybe say a word or two first before I address the specific. Fraud risks have increased exponentially during the course of the pandemic. You know, the scale of money that has come to Scotland that our public bodies have spent at pace. I mean, you know, our memories fade quickly, but we all recall, you know, the urgency, what was happening across all our lives in the early stages of the pandemic, and the need for money to get where it needed to be, for service to be delivered at real pace. Through our audit work, as I mentioned to Mr. Hoy, we'll be carrying out that assessment through the annual audit activity and assessing how well that money's been spent. There are limitations, though, of course, and fraud, by its very nature, can be difficult to detect and can last for periods of time before being assessed. So we think there's a range of factors. We've published a number of publications highlighting the need for effective and good governance for audit committees and boards to be alert to fraud risks, some of the warning signs that, you know, that typically exist in a fraud context, mentioned in introductory remarks about the cyber, the hacking risks that pertain to fraud as well. On the specific point you made about the NFI, we remain very committed to the National Fraud Initiative. We think that it represents a useful and effective both deterrent and detection method for those bodies that participate. Forgive me, Mr. Beattie, I've forgotten the exact number of fraud that has been detected over its lifetime, but tens of millions of pounds, if not hundreds of millions of pounds, I think I'm saying, has been saved to the public purse. So I think we are talking of those points you made about at the margins of public bodies or quasi-public bodies who don't voluntarily participate. Of course, we would like everybody to participate, you know, and would welcome further conversation about opportunities and arrangements to do so. It's something we can take away for, again, more conversation with our UK audit agency partners and the Cabinet Office in the UK that coordinates all of the National Fraud Initiative. Whether that then leads to mandatory participation, I hope so, and it's something we continue to engage with on the committee. But really to stress that point, that the fraud risks that public bodies are facing have grown exponentially, and we'd welcome any additional powers and focus on it to tackle those risks.
I mean, many members of the committee are new and obviously not familiar with the past history and the discussions that have taken place, but I'm pretty sure that it would be productive for that discussion to take place with a view to picking up where the previous committee was and hopefully agreeing to offer you that support. The previous committee was willing to approach the Scottish Government with a view to making this compulsory. What was unclear was what the Scottish Government has to do to make that effective. Is there actually legislation involved? Is it just guidance? How strong does it have to be?
I guess it could be either or both of those things. And probably one for us to take away and pick up with the committee after today's meeting, following further conversations with the government. As the committee will be aware that the government has a range of tools with which to require participation or cooperation through guidance, legislation, incentives given through its funding arrangements to secure participation. So it ought not to be beyond the realms of possibility that this could be resolved, given all of the other challenges that have been overcome over the past 18 months. So I think it's one that we would welcome a little bit of time and then report back to the committee how best to take it forward.
Convener, maybe this is something we can...
Yes, I was going to say, I think it's something that we would want to build into our work programme to return to this, because I think it is something that clearly is a matter of concern and interest. Auditor General, is there a register of public bodies in Scotland which do... as well as which do not take part in the National Fraud Initiative?
There is, Convener. We're very clear on which bodies are and aren't, and it is the majority. I should say there are some local factors in terms of the size of some public bodies and the nature of some. We've had discussions with the committee previously about some of those public style bodies that are outside of the traditional identification criteria of what is and isn't a public body. So we are talking about a handful, but nonetheless, we would welcome the committee's participation, interest and influence in this, and we'll do likewise.
Thank you. Thanks very much indeed. Can I turn now to Sharon Dowie, who's got a series of questions to ask. Sharon.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Boyle. I'd like to ask you a couple of questions on the Section 22 reports. So I won't ask you which bodies may be subject to the Section 22 reports this year, but can you give us an indication of how many Section 22 reports you anticipate laying before Parliament? And also, if you think there'll be an increase in the number this year, and if so, is this directly related to the COVID-19 pandemic?
Thank you. Good morning. When we produce a Section 22 report, its intended purpose is for myself as the Auditor General to bring to the Parliament's awareness matters of public interest that have arisen from an annual audit of a public body, and that the auditor has highlighted to me through their annual audit report that accompanies their audit opinion, their certificate on the financial statements. Historically, we have produced a varying number each year for the Auditor General's to the committee, depending on the circumstances that auditors have found and wish to highlight. So there's no cap, as it were, on how many we'd produce across the 200 plus public bodies that we audit, but it's tended to be in the region of perhaps 5 to 10 Section 22 reports each year. Some of those Section 22 reports have then become almost an annual feature, given the progress. So the committee maybe recall that the Scottish Police Authority, for example, received 7 or 8, as I recall, Section 22 reports since it came into existence. Section 22 report can have a reputation as it being a what went wrong style report. And for some cases, that's undeniable. You know, that there is the opportunity for me to bring to the Parliament's attention where there's been a disruption in financial sustainability, management, governance, and we'll continue to do that. But it can also have a different flavour in that, and I think that's most evident through the annual Section 22 report on the Scottish Government. Given the scale of public spending, the systemic importance of the government, that for the past 7 or 8 years now too, my predecessor and I have produced an annual Section 22 report on the Scottish Government, and I'll continue to do that and to make that commitment. So I don't have a precise number that I'm able to share today, Ms. Dowie, but we can expect that I think there'll be a marginal increase in the number that were prepared last year. Some of those, to answer your question directly, contain COVID-related factors that are in the public interest in terms of reporting, and some of those are just local specific factors that are pertain to that body. Where there are more wider thematic issues, such as digital and sponsorship, we'll also comment upon those factors too. And as I say, we'll be bringing the first of those reports in October and a number thereafter through to the end of the year.
Thank you. You actually kind of touched on it there when you mentioned it. It's known as a What Went Wrong report. So that's my next question. What are your views on publishing a Section 22 report when the annual audit has picked up exceptional work that could then be used to highlight good practice across the public sector?
I'm very supportive of that. There's an important role for us, not just on the what went wrong, not just on providing assurance. And I think I would use the catch-all of in the public interest. And the public interest is also about sharing good practice, you know, where there's been exceptional service delivery, where there's been real improvement in a public body. And that's one of the features of, I remember a conversation with Mr. Coffey in this point, that there's a point that it's important to provide a sense of closure on a public body, particularly one that has been through challenge and has come out and, you know, delivered improved financial management service delivery, and that we allow for those arrangements too. Section 22 is one of the vehicles that we can do so. All of the annual audit reports are laid before the Parliament for those public bodies that they apply to as well. And there's some thinking that we've engaged with the committee on, just that we can shine a light on those circumstances too. So, but absolutely, where there's a real exceptional level of public service performance, service delivery, Section 22 comes into that category as well, yes.
That's good. We'll change it to a What Went Right report. So one other thing I wanted to look at was, I'll just ask a quick question, in the planned performance audit reports. There's obviously quite a lot of problems just now with ferries. It's still causing issues for residents that stay in the islands, or friends and family that want to visit them for the mainland. And with us being encouraged to have staycations, it's causing problems for the local economy with people trying to go on ferries. So could I ask about the scope of the current inquiry into the new ferries, and when you plan to report on it? I know you've put it down as March 2022, but it's just to see if you think that we'll be on track to get a report then. It's obviously quite urgent.
Thank you. I'm happy to start that, and I might draw on Mark's understanding of our arrangements there too. It's an area of huge public interest, the successful delivery of the ferries for the Clyde and the Hebrides. We understand absolutely the need for this important lifeline service provision for the communities, families, visitors that rely upon them, but also the scale of public spending that has gone into the delivery of these ferries, the growth in public spending that's been required, coupled with the delay in the delivery of them. So in shaping our work, we'll be looking a bit of the history of how we got to where we are, what had been intended through the delivery of the contracts with the yard, and the arrangements that have subsequently followed. Members may recall that one of the predecessor committees in the last session of the Parliament, the Rural Economy Committee, also conducted its own investigation into this topic and made recommendations to Audit Scotland, suggesting that we also ought to look at it. So we're aware of the detail of that. We're using that to shape our work. And in terms of reporting timescales, we are on track. We don't intend to deviate from that timescale. If that changes, for whatever circumstances, we'll report back to the committee. But it's not our expectation that we'll deviate from that at the moment. I'll just check with anything that Mark wishes to add.
No, nothing further to add. I was merely going to say that I spoke to members of the audit team earlier in the week, and we remain on track to publish in March next year.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'll now turn to Willie Coffey, who's got a series of questions. Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Stephen. I was really pleased to hear that discussion just prior to this about the nature of audit, and it's not just about identifying failure, it's about identifying successes as well. And sometimes over the years, Convener, I've felt that people are scared to come to this audit committee. And it shouldn't be like that. It's about identifying opportunities for improvement and so on, that kind of agenda. That's very much my agenda with the audit. So I'm really pleased that we'll be able to shine that light on good performance in the public sector and hope that other parts of the public sector will embrace that. So I'm really looking forward to this session in that regard, Convener. I wonder, though, if I could just briefly nip back to Craig Hoy's question on following the pandemic pound. I wanted to ask you, as part of that work, will you also look at the systems that we used and deployed to distribute funds to the public sector, to businesses and communities and individuals and so on? My experience over the past 17, 18 months from a local perspective has been very much frustration on the part of businesses, communities and the public sector in gaining access to some of the COVID funds and the schemes that were in place. So will you look at that to see if we got those systems right, and whether, well, hopefully we won't be adopting schemes like this in the near future, Convener, but it's important that we look at that to make sure that we got those processes correct.
Yeah, happy to say a wee bit more about our work in that area. As well as the report, the Section 23 report that we'll be producing in May of next year, that will cover COVID-related spending across Scotland's public services, we'll also be producing a briefing paper on some of the economic implications and the support that businesses have received later this year or maybe early into 2022 to support the Section 23 that will follow thereafter. Like you, Mr. Coffey, I think we've all been aware of some of the concerns that businesses have raised about the pace, the arrangements and the access to some of the much needed financial support that came from the Scottish Government. And we'll be looking at aspects of that during the course of that briefing paper. The wider judgments will come through the Section 22 report and beyond. But in its general sense is that, and maybe just to kind of connect to your introductory remark, is that there is a need for innovation in public services. There's an audit dimension to that too, that yes, we want to support assurance and accountability, but not in a way that strangles both innovation, improvement that's so needed in our public services, the rapid digitalisation that will have to come. So we'll be commenting on all of those cross-cutting themes over the years ahead, but certainly in the specifics, we'll be doing both the briefing paper and the Section 23 report that will cover, I hope, the areas that you're interested in.
Okay, thank you for that. Could I turn, Convener, to the exciting topic of the government's consolidated accounts? Some of the recommendations from our predecessor committee touched on themes about how we invest in support for private companies and providing whole sector public accounts. Those themes cropped up from time to time in discussion about that. What do you see? Has the government made any progress in addressing these issues? And how do you see that work being taken forward?
The members of the committee may recall that there was when your predecessor committee took evidence earlier this year from the Scottish Government on this topic, you heard again a strong commitment to the importance of a Scottish public sector accounts for Scotland, but reasonable evidence that the pandemic and its implications had interrupted the progress of producing a really necessary missing component of financial reporting in Scotland's public services. Audit Scotland, my predecessor and I, have made the case many times that Scotland has an incomplete financial picture of all of its assets, liabilities, revenue and expenditure. and it needs to have this in order to support parliamentary scrutiny and public understanding. And also touching on some of the decisions that Scotland as a country will want to make in the years to come. We've touched on in our paper some of the aspects of kind of longer term financial sustainability, the choices, the liabilities and opportunities that exist around areas of interest that the committee have touched on in previous years around private finance initiatives, pension arrangements for public services, and none of that exists in one single source. I'm not trying to make the case for it again, Mr. Coffey, but I hope that helps. But it really, there is a need for government to pick up the pace and produce it. We're continuing to engage with them, and as ever, we've welcomed the committee's support in its legacy paper on the need for this to happen. We expect to see progress this year.
Okay, thank you for that one. If I could turn to one of the comments you made about monitoring performance. One of the key functions in audit is to close the loop, to make sure that your recommendations are carried out and implemented, and we and the public can see the benefits of that. How do you envisage that working? Do you plan to do it by report, or do you envisage us and the public being able to gaze, to dip in, to see the performance of public bodies that you look at for themselves, to ask questions and perhaps to monitor how they're performing? Or is it down to you and down to us to do that, do you think?
So I think there's a range of factors to it. I think most fundamentally there is an onus on all public bodies that they themselves are clear and transparent about how they are effectively discharging their use of public funds. And they'll do that through a range of factors. You know, the most traditional would be their own annual report and accounts that are subject to independently appointed auditors by myself and the Accounts Commission, and that they, you know, are transparent in their operations. They hold meetings in public, subject to good governance, leadership, all of the factors you expect of a well-run public body that can show how it is spending money. As you say, we've produced reports on public bodies over many years. We've got a range of tools at our disposal. So as well as the report, the briefing, any evidence sessions that the committee chooses to hold with accountable officers, we also produce impact reports or follow-up reports in a period after the initial recommendations to assess what happened next, effectively. And we'll continue to do that. Mark may wish to come in a moment to say a bit more about how we expect that to proceed. I think the other thing that we've touched on in passing this morning is about really that recommendations and the effectiveness of those recommendations that come from public audit. We're really committed to that. We'd like to see that happen a bit more quickly. As I mentioned, that we've heard of accountable officers make the commitment and acceptance of the recommendations, but that doesn't just turn into a one-off event. That they can close the loop, as you suggest. And there's options around that, whether that's on a report-by-report basis or whether it's across more thematic areas. I think it probably be a bit of a horses-for-courses thing, if I'm being honest, as recommendations change, where reports are related. And I think also plays into options for the committee too, about where, if you're seeing recurring themes from audit reports, as predecessor committees have done, taking the opportunity to step back and say, is there a wider issue here? Should we draw in evidence, round tables, as it were, from a range of sources? So we are keen to progress on all of those fronts, Mr. Coffey, to ensure that accountability loop and improvement is sustained. But I'll just invite Mark to see if there's anything else that he wishes to add.
Thank you. Yes, absolutely. It's a really important kind of bit of the system that we kind of want to try and develop. As Stephen said, we monitor the kind of the impact of our reports in a variety of ways and report on that in a variety of ways. And we're in the context of the predecessor committee's legacy report, we're looking again at how best we do that. And I think there's a really important conversation between the committee, with the Auditor General and Audit Scotland and the government to have about how best to do that. it is complex. There are a range of different types of recommendations that we make, and some are very broad and strategic and will take a long time to implement. Others are much more specific and much more focused. So there's not sort of one size fits all in terms of how we do it. So we want to have a think about that in discussion with yourselves and also in discussion with the government about how we can set up the most effective system to do it. But as Stephen says, we're absolutely committed to so this is a key part of the system of accountability that we think we can enhance.
Good, thank you for that. And probably lastly, yes, for me, if I can, convener, Stephen, you mentioned as one of your key themes, the whole digital transformation issue. You came in at the end of your presentation on that. And in many ways, the digital technology during the pandemic, convener, probably saved a lot of jobs and a lot of businesses, I think, in the way that they adapted quickly to use the technology. The capabilities of the technology were always there, but we didn't perhaps embrace them and use them in those particular ways. So I'm interested in what your approach and an audit perspective, from an audit perspective, will be to looking at those issues and what you hope to get out of that.
Thank you for the question, actually. And I'll say a word or two and I'll swiftly hand over to Mark. He, as well as our programme development responsibilities, he's very closely involved in our digital auditing arrangements too. Really, to echo your observation, is that the technologies existed, but yet we didn't use them. And it's for good and for bad, I would say, and perhaps we don't yet know, and the need for a qualities impact assessment, factors that we've touched on about. Public bodies will want to think really carefully about how they use digital technologies in the years to come through their own digital strategies, assessing how well they've been used over the course of the pandemic, for all the good that it's brought about, you know, swiftness of access, sustainability of public services. We know and we've heard examples of where a very quick shift to digital has excluded some access to services, you know, whether it's through GP appointments and so forth. So we're drawing in those factors. We're also using our own digital auditing strategy how we as public auditors are using technology to enhance our own assurance and reach into public service to provide that improvement and assurance focus to our work. I'll certainly say that Mark will be better placed just to kind of give the committee a bit of flavour about how we're best doing that.
I think just to reiterate what Stephen says, what we've heard from public bodies is that the pace of change in terms of the use of digital technology has been extraordinary over the last 18 months. Anecdotally, we've heard people talking about things which would have taken 5 years have happened in 5 months, if not quicker than that. So absolutely recognise what you're saying, Mr. Coffey, about the speed at which things have happened. I think it's fair to say that our kind of overarching observation was that across the public sector, public bodies vary in the extent of their digital maturity and the extent to which they are using digital technology. There are some which are very much on the front foot, others which are having to catch up very, very rapidly. Stephen mentioned earlier about digital exclusion, and that's an area that we're absolutely planning performance audit work in the medium term, and we're having conversations and are thinking very hard about how best to do that. Again, we are conscious of the risks that the kind of shift to greater use of digital technology is going to potentially exacerbate inequalities that have already existed and prove challenging to some people and some communities in accessing public services. In terms of our future work, I think you will see digital being a thread which runs through a variety of different types of, in particular, performance audit work. I'll just go back to the justice system, which we spoke about earlier on. In future performance audit work in that area, we may well be looking at the use of digital technology and digital courts, virtual courts, and how that's being used, how effective that is for users of the court system, and how effective it's being in terms of trying to manage the backlog in court cases that happens. So there'll be specific work. In particular, I'd highlight potential work on digital exclusion, but I think it will also make an appearance in a number of different performance audits as a key thread in terms of how public services are being delivered.
That's really interesting. So in the future, if the public sector businesses or otherwise choose to continue to embrace the digital solutions that were put in place during COVID, will you be looking to see if they are having those impacts on exclusion and so on and so forth? It's maybe not a typical audit perspective, but is that a key feature, do you think, to make sure or to look to see if people are more excluded than they were perhaps before digital technology was embraced to the degree it was during COVID?
Absolutely. I think it's one of the risks that we want to look at and want to assess to see to what extent for particular groups, particular communities, that has been the case. So very much so. Going back to your earlier point about highlighting good practice, we are trying to capture examples of things that we are seeing over the last 18 months where there has been really good, really, really progressive practice, and trying to highlight that as well. So that will be a strand of our digital work as well. So there'll be both sides of that equation.
Good, that's great. Thanks very much. Thanks, Convener.
Did you want to come back in, Steve?
Thanks, Convener. I think I agree with everything Mark said, Mr. Coffey. The only thing I would add, of course, is that there's a real onus on public bodies too. You know, where they have implemented technology at pace and changed the nature of service delivery and access arrangements, they'll also want to review how well that's gone and make the necessary acceleration or adjustments in consultation with their service users and their governance arrangements too.
That was quite a change, a substantial change in how we operate, which there's plenty of evidence for that. Will you look at how we did the work that we did?
So we're very mindful of the scope of our work in the Parliament, actually, and it's something that we'd be happy to discuss with the parliamentary authorities if that was felt appropriate.
Thank you. Thanks very much.
Yes, I think some of us are maybe more concerned about whether people can access their GP and what their what their sense of that service is and has been and might be in the future. Craig Hoy, I think, wants to come in with a brief question related to this area.
Thank you. It's actually a little bit unrelated, actually, but just one thing that hasn't come up today is the government's plan for the creation of a national care service. And when we last talked, obviously we discussed the role that Audit Scotland might have in relation to that. The First Minister called the proposed national care service this week perhaps the biggest public sector reform that this Parliament has ever undertaken. And given the scale and the scope of the proposed national care service, which could touch adult social care, children's services, social work, drug and alcohol services, GP provision, and the criminal justice system, what role do you see Audit Scotland having in relation to the development of that policy in the national care service, so that we can achieve good outcomes and don't in perhaps 5 or 10 years' time be producing maybe what could be one of the largest what went wrong reports in the history of the Parliament?
Yeah, thank you. So we would recognise the significance of the extent of public sector reform that the National Care Service is proposing. Clearly the consultation is ongoing at the moment, and the timescales suggest that this will take a number of years to go through full consultation before the new arrangements are settled. We have some history specifically with health and social care integration. We've produced a number of reports already that the predecessor committees have considered, and we've commented quite clearly about the lack of pace with which health and social care integration had made in Scotland, the lack of change in outcomes that was necessary for users of health and social care in the country. In terms of the audit role, I would say that there are parallels to our involvement in other areas of where there was significant public sector change, perhaps most notably recently with the introduction of new powers to Scotland following the Scotland Acts, and our engagement that then led to the Social Security Scotland, its creation and the adoption of new Social Security powers in the country, that Audit Scotland was around that work in a quite a different way than it, perhaps the traditional audit voice had been heard. As you rightly say, Mr. Hoy, we weren't keen in being in the place that we came along a number of years after the implementation of it. With questionable value, I would say that that's where the auditor would be. We'd much rather be alongside the implementation and development of policy, mindful of the appropriate boundaries of it, but that we can comment upon the progress of implementation. So we're thinking very carefully about that, about tracking the consultation, the responses. And I think for us, it's one of the benefits of this Agile programme, that we don't have to wait 6-12 months to refine our programme, which that we can do so quite quickly. And I fully expect that, you know, when we're next in front of the committee talking about our programme, once we're clear into 2022, is that we'll have a comprehensive programme of work that will last a number of years and reporting steps therein on the new National Care Service as it progresses. Thank you.
And coming towards the end of this session, you mentioned about agility there and new ways of working, and you've explained in the written report about the move towards blogs and briefings. I suppose my question is, Audit Scotland in the last two decades has built up a very powerful reputation for being authoritative, forensic, making recommendations which are clearly evidence-led. My first question is, therefore, how are you going to safeguard that reputation in a world of blogs and briefings? And secondly, how do you see the mechanism working for referring that work to the committee, just to reassure us that that there will be ample opportunity for us to work with you and scrutinise things that you uncover through those routes?
I'll maybe address the first part of your question, convener, and Mark, invite him to talk about the referral arrangements and the specifics of the legislative powers around our work. Our thinking in terms of the need for an agile programme had been in place before the pandemic, and we had moved in that direction over a number of years. So briefings and blogs had become a component of our outputs since probably the last 5 or 6 years, that gave us the opportunity, both my predecessor and myself and colleagues, through blogs to comment on areas of public audit interest and performance, often to signal future audit work. So I think for me, it's not an instead of, it's an addition to, if I can characterise it in those terms. And particularly our briefing papers, as we've done through the COVID, the tracker, perhaps the best example, is that as the pace of that money was being spent, we're not in a position to comment how well that money's been spent. Has value for money been achieved? Some of those judgments can take a period of time to reach. Absolutely endorse the point that you make. They have to be evidence-led. So it's a complementary range of outputs from our perspective, always rooted in robust evidence analysis and judgments that are formed thereafter. And for me, that feels like the appropriate place for us to be, that the alternative would be that the public auditor would have remained silent on many areas of public spending and interest for a period of huge increase in public spending, focus on public services. So for me, that felt like the right place for us to be, the additionality, as opposed to pushing out some of the robust performance auditing. As ever, we'll keep that under review. And I think that characters, again, the nature of this more flexible work programme allows us to do those things and draw in events into our thinking along with the risks and priorities. I'll maybe pause for a second and invite Mark, if there's anything he wishes to say about the nature of how that flows through to the committee and the choices that the committee, of course, then have about how to use our work in any briefings you wish to take on them.
Thank you. So the way that we envisage the process working is the Parliament's standing orders allow the Auditor General to refer material relating to audit work and to accounts to the committee. So in discussion with the clerks, we proposed that the Auditor General writes to you, convener, sort of when we have published a new briefing or a new blog, and sort of just highlight that is now sort of available in public domain, and should the committee decide to pursue that and to take evidence of it, we would of course be very happy to support that and provide any additional briefing that we can. I'll just go back to your comments sort of about sort of the evidence-led nature of our audit work and sort of the reputation that we've built up over the last 20 years. All these new materials we exist within our existing quality control framework. So we have a system by which facts are checked with audited bodies where appropriate and so on and so forth. So that's something which we're very confident about in terms of this remains a very much an evidence-led approach to getting material out, but it does allow us to do things more quickly and more sharply, as Stephen's described.
Okay, thank you very much. And on that note, can I thank Stephen Boyle and Mark Roberts for your evidence this morning? It's been extremely illuminating and very helpful for us to understand your priorities and your work programme, which in turn will feed into ours. So can I thank you both for your time this morning? And can I now close the public session and move to private session? Thank you.